Even in the 21st century, parts of the Lake District look very much like they must have in Wordsworth's time, and even before that, for the characters in his poem Michael. And then came the Industrial Revolution.
The Stott Bobbin Mill is an example of how the Industrial Revolution put cottage industries like Michael out of business.
Look at the first lines of the poem. If from the public way you turn your steps up the tumultuous brook of Greenhead Gill, you will suppose that with an upright path your feet must struggle. In such bold ascent the pastoral mountains front you face to face. But courage, for around that boisterous brook the mountains have all opened out themselves and made a hidden valley of their own. No habitation can be seen, but they who journey thither find themselves alone with a few sheep, with rocks and stones, and kites that overhead are sailing in the sky. It is in truth an utter solitude, nor should I have made mention of this dell but for one object which you might pass by, might see and notice not. Beside the brook appears a straggling heap of unhewn stones, and to that simple object appertains a story, unenriched with strange events, yet not unfit, I deem, for the fireside or for the summer shade. It was the first of those domestic tales that spake to me of shepherds, dwellers in the valleys, men whom I already loved, not verily for their own sakes, but for the fields and hills where was their occupation and abode.
This signpost points to the public footpath that leads to Greenhead Gill. If you follow this path, you'll come to Greenhead Gill, where Michael, the shepherd in Wordsworth's poem, lived with his son Luke. This is the brook that runs down from the mountainside where Michael lived. It was beside the brook like this that Wordsworth saw the straggling heap of unhewn stone, and it reminded him of the story of Michael the shepherd. The valley that runs between these two hills is Greenhead Gill. This wall that I'm standing beside is a good example of the kind of stacked stone walls that you'll find running up and over the mountainsides throughout the Lake District in England. They're actually made of stones that are stacked up without mortar. And this is exactly the kind of structure that Wordsworth was referring to in his poem, Michael. In line 16, he says that beside the brook appears a straggling heap of unhewn stones, and to that simple object appertains a story. As we find so often in romantic poetry, there's something in the natural world that the poet sees, and that leads the poet on into a meditation. This time, Wordsworth's meditating on the story of Michael the shepherd, and how his life and his lifestyle came to an end. Wordsworth's Michael belonged to a family that for generations had made their living by raising sheep, shearing the wool, even spinning the wool into thread and weaving it into cloth. With the advent of the Industrial Revolution, that lifestyle was no longer possible, for the people in the Lake District. Michael is an example of a person who's caught in that conflict. In line 380 of the poem, we find that Michael has decided to send Luke into the city in order to work and make enough money to pay off a debt that he owes on part of the land. In line 380, "Heaven forgive me, Luke, if I judge ill for thee, but it seems good that thou shouldst go." At this the old man paused, then, pointing to the stones near which they stood, thus after a short silence he resumed, "This was a work for us, and now, my son, it is a work for me." He's referring, of course, to the building of the stacked stone sheepfold that he had planned to build with Luke. Now he's going to continue the work on the land on his own while Luke does his part by going into the city, which for Wordsworth represented the place of evil and corruption, the place where the common people who lived in the valleys like this one and who made their living in the rural seclusion and now were no longer able to do so because of the Industrial Revolution. Michael asked his son Luke to lay one stone in the sheepfold. That one stone is going to be a covenant, an agreement, a promise that Luke will return to resume the lifestyle that Michael loved so much. In line 386, "But lay one stone. Here, lay it for me, Luke, with thine own hands. Nay, boy, be of good hope." At that point, we can almost imagine Luke breaking into tears as his father tells him he's going to leave this land where he's lived his entire life. "Nay, boy, be of good hope. We both may live to see a better day. At 84, I am still strong and hale. Do thou thy part, I will do mine." Later, just a few lines later in the poem, Wordsworth tells us that Luke failed in his duty. In line 442, Wordsworth tells us, "Meantime, Luke began to slacken in his duty, and at length he, in the dissolute city, gave himself to evil courses." We don't know exactly what crime Luke committed or what evil he committed. Apparently, Wordsworth didn't think the particulars were important. What is important is that Luke, the innocent, simple country boy, has gone into the city and fallen into evil, so much so that he has to leave the country. Then Wordsworth turns our attention back to Michael. "There is a comfort in the strength of love. 'Twill make a thing endurable, which else would overset the brain or break the heart." I have conversed with more than one who well remember the old man and what he was years after he had heard this heavy news. And then at the end of the poem, in about line 465, we have the very sad picture of Michael. "'Tis believed by all that many and many a day he thither went," referring to the sheepfold that he was building, "and never lifted up a single stone. There, by the sheepfold, sometimes was he seen sitting alone, or with his faithful dog, then old, beside him lying at his feet. The length of full 7 years, from time to time, he at the building of this sheepfold wrought, and left the work unfinished when he died."